a software engineer. I'm used to huddling in dark corners, so bear with me. Okay. So we'll be talking a bit about simple text query, reference depositing, and RefExpress. Kind of a common thread between all these things is we're looking at unstructured citations and how they're handled in various ways in the system. Excuse me. So we'll look first at the simple text query form, and then we'll take a brief look at the simple text query upload form, and then we'll look at the deposit process and how those unstructured citations are handled in your deposits. Hopefully all of you are familiar with this. This is the interactive simple text query where you paste your references. This handles up to 15K worth of data. That's about 100 references, unless your references are extremely long, then it may be less. This returns DOIs as well as PubMed and PubMed Central IDs. And this interface also allows you to deposit cited by deposits directly into the system from the form. The limitation, by the way, is somewhat artificial. It's just that, you know, on an interactive form, there's only so long you're going to wait for a result. And, you know, so we set a cutoff, and that seems to be about 15K. Otherwise, you know, you run into timeouts or you get bored waiting for it to come back. But that is, of course, why we created the simple text query upload. So you don't have to stand around waiting for it. If you have a larger list of references that you want to look up, then you can just upload the file. And this doesn't require you to wait around. Now, this accepts up to 50K worth of data, and that it says for now, because this the simple text query interactive form has actually been moved into the system at this point, into the new code. The upload is about to get that treatment, and that will change the way that we handle volumes of, you know, large quantities of citations, so we can buffer it in smaller chunks and handle more. So that will likely go up. I can't promise what that will be, but for now, just assume 50K. This also returns the same DOIs, PubMed, and PubMed Central IDs, but in an email as an attachment. Now, in the deposit process, this is where it's taking your citation lists from your deposit, looking for unstructured citations. You saw earlier when Chuck discussed deposits that, you know, you could have DOIs, you could have metadata deposited, and you could also have unstructured citations. This is dealing with the unstructured citations component of that. This uses several parsers to try to parse it into metadata to perform the query, and then queries our system to generate the cited by links to the DOIs. And also, as you stated earlier, if it doesn't, to create the stored queries to reprocess at a later time. And this is just basically the simple graphic of the flow, your unstructured citations coming in the XML. Of course, I picked ones here that just had unstructured citations. So those are the ones we care about in this talk. And creates the metadata queries, which results in either a DOI or a stored query for each of the citations listed. Now we'll take a little deeper look into each of these and look at how to best use them. For the STQ and the STQ upload, we're starting with your references UTF-8 encoded. We need to see those foreign characters properly encoded to get good accurate results. The STQ uses a couple of parsers, which we'll go into in greater detail, to parse it into metadata. And then we run the metadata against the system, again for the DOIs. And then we also query PubMed to get the PubMed and PubMed Central IDs. Now look at the kind of the building blocks that work under the hood here. The two first things mentioned are the parsers, the formatted citation parser, the Refex, this is Enera's product that we license, the RefExpress parser. Then we'll talk a little bit about the formatted citation search option. And we'll look at how user permissions affect how these services are implemented, and the special case of high volume users and what we can do specifically to handle if any of you are dealing with very, very high volume deposits. There are options that are available to you. Now, the formatted citation parser, this is our own code, our own parser. It handles some common formats. It doesn't get anything, it doesn't get everything by any stretch of the imagination. It is our code, though, so it's continually developing. This depends on line breaks for identifying where the breaks are between citations, so you need those hard returns between citations and not within citations. It's very quick. We have no usage limits on this, and it's available to everybody all the time. The common citation formats, you know, typically these are the type of citations that it's used to seeing. You know, it does a great number of journals, some books. It doesn't do very well with some other things, a PhD thesis it hasn't been trained for yet. There are some sorts of papers and reports that it doesn't do particularly well on. Now, the RefExpress parse service, this is the component that we license from Anera. This has a lot more formats in it. It's a fairly robust system. It also can handle some things that we don't in our own parser, and that is it can find things that are split or wrapped improperly and actually put them back together. I'll have an example of that later. It can also split compound references. There are some specialties that use a citation format that allows you to have more than one citation and a reference. We'll look at an example of that, and it will find the individual citations and look up the DOIs for them. This one's not as fast, it because this is kind of an outside component that we link to, you know, do requests to. It can take more time with references, you know, short lists, maybe only 15 seconds, but you can go upwards of a minute if you throw a lot at it all at once. It does have usage limits, and that's, of course, because we do license it, so we do have some restrictions. So we have, to control costs, we set some limits on this. Now, formatted citation search, as Chuck explained earlier, there's a difference between querying and searching. This is a search tool. This does a full-text search against an index of references. It's very fast. It is unlimited, but it is by default not enabled, and it's for the last reason. It's not as precise. This is more of a fuzzy match style search, where, you know, our default philosophy is if you query for something, you get one and only one result. If it finds multiple things, you get nothing. If it finds the one right result, that's what you get. This doesn't really follow this rule. That rule. This is more of a fuzzy logic type thing. So this we didn't want to implement automatically because we want you to know what you're getting. So a decision has to be made before we implement this for anyone's account. And the main reason for doing something like that would be high volume users. We have had some people who have had extremely large numbers of citations that they wanted to process. If you're hitting a limit on RefExpress, you would actually know because here, if you notice, you may not be able to see it very well on this, but the blue line there notes that you have exceeded your monthly usage for the RefExpress service. So if you do hit that limit and, you know, you have circumstance that requires you to do that, you should talk to us. Contact support. We'll work with you to find solutions that solve your problems. If you're doing very, very high volume traffic, then you may want to consider using the formatted citation search. That can handle very large volumes, and if you are interested in that, please also contact support. Now, this is just a simple flow of the way it works. Citations coming in through the simple text query or the upload are first sent against the formatted citation parser, which, as you know, is always enabled. That kind of gets the low-hanging fruit. That's the first line of defense. The parser will parse the results if possible. If we get parsed metadata queries, it sends those queries against the database and returns the DOIs to the user. Anything that's unparsed is then passed to the RefExpress parser, presumably enabled, since that's the default. And then it attempts to parse them, and any metadata queries that are processed by that are then passed also to the query service to return a DOI. Now, anything unparsed there gets passed to the formatted citation search, which, as I noted, is turned off by default. So if that were turned on in your instance for high volume usage, it would then throw it against that service as well to look for DOIs. And it returns to you the either your original citation or your original citation with the citations and PubMed IDs where they are available. Now, best practices for using this, again, are UTF-8 encoding of the characters. That gets the best result. The line breaks between references, not within references. This third one is actually specifically a note as to how the RefExpress parser works to determine where breaks are in references and to piece together things when they aren't in the ideal situation. It depends on one of two schemes, and that is that it looks for the references to be numbered sequentially or alphabetical, which, as Bruce explained to me, is the only way you would typically do a bibliography anyway. If you're doing a bibliography section, it's going to fall into one of those anyhow. Use common citation formats. And last but not least, if you're planning to do a cited by deposit from this, you have to make sure that you do not use the list all possible DOIs for each reference. It doesn't allow you to do a deposit to multiple DOIs. It has to be a one-to-one relationship. Now, I'll look at a few examples. This is an example set of citations, fairly simple, run-of-the-mill stuff. They're numbered. They're common format, fairly complete. This, as you would expect, produces very good results. You have DOIs and PubMed IDs. Only the last one, which did parse into metadata, did not find a DOI. Here's one that's not quite right. The basic information here is correct, the author, the title, but this doesn't follow an established citation format. The punctuation in it doesn't delimit the authors from the year properly. But if you note the four versions of it below, any one of those will get the result correctly, because those are properly formatted citations. Last one, of course, is the best one, because it also has the most complete information. So that will, of course, give you the most reliable results. This was a very strange one that we ran into. This came into support for a query that didn't succeed. May not really be of much help, because this would be a very hard one to diagnose if you ran into it. The citation at the top is correctly formatted, and it is the correct information for the article, but it doesn't result in a DOI. We had to do a little digging on this one to figure out why it wasn't actually working. And according to the publisher's data, which you can note in the XML in the middle, it actually declared that Sylvia Day is the given name, and Zhang is the, pardon my pronunciation, I probably have it wrong, is the surname. The parser assumes that anything, you know, Vander or Day or Dela, you know, that those indefinite articles are part of the surname. So when it parsed it, it determined that this was Dijong was the surname. And what is in the data is just Zhang. So this didn't match simply because the author in its interpretation was wrong. But this is, as far as we can tell from the data, is correct. But that's a very small case. And probably every other case I've ever seen, the way that we parse it would be correct. And in this one, I tweaked the query at the bottom. I basically just dropped that article Day out of it, and it worked fine. But this does show that these citations can be a little bit particular. So you may cite something and not get a result. It may not be readily apparent why. I wouldn't expect you to figure this one out, but definitely contact support when you run into odd problems like this. They do warrant investigation. This is the sample of a compound query. If you note the semicolons within the citation, actually, well, within the reference, delimit the different citations in here. To the eye, that's fairly easy to pick out, but for machines, that's not as obvious. But this shows one of the capabilities that's nice about the RefExpress parser, in that it was able to determine that there were actually three different items referenced in that, and did return the metadata for each of them. And then it went against the system and found DOIs for all three of them. Now, this is an example of a poorly wrapped citation. This is just one reference, but it's broken in the middle. This demonstrates some of the nicer RefExpress capabilities as well, at finding things that are not wrapped properly. Again, this is not best practice. We don't recommend that you throw a bunch of line breaks in there to challenge it. But in this case, it was able to find where it was broken, put it back together, and the result it returned had one citation and the appropriate DOI for it. Now, this is basically just a step through of using the cited by deposit, just so it's clear to everyone the process here. This is just a sample deposit of a few citations. Note that you do not check the box for list all possible DOIs per reference. And when you get your results, the deposit button is available because you didn't click that. So you click deposit, and that will expose the necessary fields for actually submitting the deposit. So you enter your email, you enter the DOI of the citing article, your system username and password, and this will perform the deposit, and you'll get your normal email as you would with deposits with your results. Okay, now we're looking at some deposit process data here. It's a little harder to look at this because this is not, you know, this is not an interactive form. This is something that's happening on your data behind the scenes. So what I've done here is the blue line here is actually a log reference from a deposit, and it gives you the pound R. There is the number of references that came in. If you skip on over to UNSTR, that's the number of unstructured citations that were in this deposit. And you'll see there were 38. Next to it, UNPAR is unparsed. So those are the ones that were not successfully parsed. So in this deposit, 34 out of 38 were successfully parsed. And I pasted in some of the citations that came in this deposit. And you can see that things are well-formed, well-formatted citations with fairly complete data. You can see why that would work. This is the type of result we hope to see. Here's one that had five unstructured citations and none of them parsed. Looking at these citations, you know, we like to look at the data every once in a while and see why things aren't being recognized. In this case, I think these are just types of citations that, well, I know our parser doesn't know some of these. I assume that RefExpress wasn't able to handle some of these as well because they're not parsed. But you can see a couple of them are unpublished PhD theses. Looks like one is a geology report. So these are not your typical books and journals. I assume that this, if these are actually following a known citation format, we can expect that in the future we'll improve on the number of these different types of data sources that are recognized. So I'm not sure if it's, in this case, if it's a citation formatting issue or just that the parsers, neither of the parsers know. In case of RefExpress, we're, you know, it's a black box to us, so we don't know exactly what it's doing inside. Now, these are some statistics for the traffic that the simple text query has been handling. This is just July, August, and September. STQ submissions are the number of form submissions. So you can see in the last, in September, over 22,000 uses of the form. Raw references are the number of citations that were in those reference lists. So again, for September, you can see there's almost 225,000 that we processed. The references parsed, that's how many successfully were parsed into metadata queries, 182,000 in September. That's pretty good, 182,000, that's over 81% of them were parsed into metadata queries. And then the DOIs that were returned, let's see, last line, over 160,000 DOIs. That's almost 88% of the ones that were turned into metadata queries returned DOIs. So that's pretty impressive. And you can see that the numbers are growing month by month at rather a significant rate. even if we were just to extrapolate out based on things staying the same, just on September numbers, we're looking at 2.7 million references per year and parsing 2.2 million metadata queries and returning almost 2 million DOIs. So even if it didn't go up, it's still doing quite a bit of work. Now, statistics for the deposit process are not really as easy to come by, and the numbers aren't as linear because, of course, the traffic of the publishers isn't as linear here. Some publishers have decided to go back and resubmit their data with references now that that feature is available. So from July, we had 1.4 million references. Then in August, we see a little over 800,000, and we're back up to 1.2 million. So there's a lot more fluctuation in it, usually because of the activity of the publishers resubmitting stuff. Now, the number of references parsed here is also lower than what we saw in the prior slide. We're only seeing 35-40% of them. Part of that may be that the use of this has not really become second nature to the publishers yet. So we have seen, there was one publisher that deposited references that weren't really using the citation lists correctly. And when we actually dug into it, because it was causing some performance issues, we found that they were putting the entire full text of their documents into the citation. So Parser wasn't very happy with that. Didn't perform very fast on those either. But that will throw off the percentage return. Now, the reason there's no number of DOIs found, our current logging doesn't actually tell us DOIs resolved at the end of the process. So this is kind of a limitation in our current logging. So we may address that in the future. But just based on what we saw in the prior slide, we know that once you get to a metadata query, the percentage of them that return a DOI is very high. I mean, we were seeing 80 to 90% there. So we assume that that number, if we could actually track it more accurately, would be quite high when you get to the DOI line. Apparently, I spoke very fast because I'm 10 minutes under. I kind of figured that would happen. So coming up, you'll be hearing about the PDF processor. This is an up-and-coming thing. It will be interesting to many of you, I'm sure, taking a PDF document, extracting XML, and creating deposits directly from it. And again, if you have any questions, don't hesitate to contact us.